think it's no secret to anybody out there that one of the toughest men that I've ever stepped in the ring against in my entire career has been Dutch Mantel. No matter what you think about Dutch personally, you've got to admit, you got to respect his wrestling ability because he's one of the best. The guy's capable of beating anybody that he steps in the ring with, and I know this for a fact because he's beaten me in the past. You see, I think a lot of people think that all the wrestlers are friends and big pals just because maybe they see them as partners. They probably think they're best friends. Well, this is not always the case because, you see, it's hard to form a lasting friendship with somebody when you may wind up wrestling them somewhere down the line. Now, that's just the case with Dutch. I wrestled him in the past, but we've also been partners in the past. And after what took place here a couple of weeks ago on TV when he came to help me, when those two big goons jumped me, I feel like that Dutch and I are friends. And what even more bonds that friendship is the fact that he helped me even after I'd refused him a shot at the Southern Heavyweight title right here, which he thinks that he deserves, and I agree that he deserves. But you see, I told him that this is the only ticket that I have to wrestling Ric Flair, a match that I think I deserve. But naturally, any wrestler, it's his goal, his dream, his ambition to be the World Heavyweight Championship or champion. And Dutch is certainly no exception. He would like to have that match with Ric Flair. So I asked him if he would be my partner against those two big clowns that I would give him a shot at this belt. He more than fulfilled his end of the bargain, and now it's time for me to fulfill mine. But what I'm looking forward to about this match is the fact that I don't think it's going to have to be a fight like it was in the past. I think it's going to be a wrestling match to see who the best man is, and I think that's what wrestling is all about. So, Dutch, I just want to say that I'm looking forward to this. You're going to get your shot at the heavyweight championship, and I'm going to shake your hand before the match starts, and win, lose, or draw, I'm going to shake it when it's over. Because, like I said, Dutch, somewhere down the line, I want you and I to be partners and go after the World Tag Team titles. So I'll see you in the ring, and I want to wish you all the luck in the world. But like I said, this is my only shot at the World Heavyweight Championship, Dutch, and I don't look forward to losing it. So I'll see you in the ring.
Okay, there's King talking about an upcoming match that he's going to have with the Dutchman. He promised it to him, and boy, I would love to see those two guys together as a tag team shooting for those world titles. There's something else indeed.
Okay, we got ourselves an excellent match coming up here, another tag action match. It'll have Sweet Brown Sugar coming in here with his partner, beautiful Bob Eaton, and here's the Dutchman. Dutch, we are delighted to have you out here. We heard just a few moments ago from the King about the upcoming match that you got for the big Southern Heavyweight title.
Okay, this is what I've been waiting on for a long time, and I don't know if Jerry Lawler's been looking forward to it, but we made a deal, and I'll tell my end now it's time to uphold his. You know, a lot of people say that myself and Jerry Lawler are a lot alike, and we are a lot alike in a lot of ways, but there's one big glaring difference. Jerry Lawler, and a lot of people might not want to hear this, but I'm going to tell them just exactly the way it is. Jerry Lawler is a con man, and he is a liar from the word go. Now, a lot of people don't want to believe that, but I'm going to tell it the way it is. Because just last week, he came out here on this very same television program, and he says, and they showed a little film clip of Jerry Lawler pulling chains, throwing fire, and doing what is necessary to win a match. And he came back and says, now, I am the Jerry Lawler, the king of old. Now, that's last week, that's got to mean that it remains true today. But yet, he comes out here today, and he turns over a whole new leaf. He goes 180 degrees in the opposite direction, saying, well, I'm looking forward to the match, and I'm going to wrestle Dutch Mantel. Hey, I'm not that stupid. This is not my first time to the rodeo, because I know Jerry Lawler. He might wrestle as long as he's on top. But when he's not on top, he's going to be scrambling, baby. He's going to be digging. He's going to be grabbing this, that, and the other, and doing whatever is necessary to win that Southern belt. He is right. That is his ticket to the world champion, Ric Flair, but it's also my ticket, too, because whoever has that Southern belt is going to wrestle Ric Flair. And I'm going to say one thing about Lawler. He's not going to wrestle me. He said, I'd like to shake your hand before and ask him that. Hey, he'd like to maybe stick his hand out and then cold cock me one good time. Hey, I'm not stupid. But when I go in that ring, I'm going to go in there loaded for bear. I'm going in there to beat Lawler because I beat him before and I can do it again. Jerry Lawler says what the people want to hear. And I come out here and tell the truth. He's probably got a lot more fans than what I got. But I'm coming out here and telling it the way it is, and the way it's going to be done, it's going to be done my way. See, Jerry Lawler, he loves that Southern belt. He loves it with every ounce of energy in his body. He loves that belt. He loves to wear. He loves the fame and the glory that he can get from that Southern belt. Everywhere Jerry Lawler goes, people come, oh, Jerry Lawler, oh, we love you. Sign this, do this. because he's got the Southern belt. And that's his ticket to Ric Flair. You know, he even, I think, sleeps with that belt. But he ain't going to sleep with it no more, buddy, because the next time we step in the ring, Lawler, we're not going to wrestle. We're going to fight, because we're fighting over careers and we're fighting over lives, because I'm after it and you're trying to keep it. And when I crawl on that ring with you, Lawler, buddy, it's not going to be a wrestling match. It's going to be a fight. And we're going to fight it out, and I'm going to beat you. I've done it before, and I can do it again. I'm getting sick and tired of getting pushed in the background, being an also-ran or waiting for somebody to get hurt so I might be able to get a shot at it. I'm sick and tired of all that, and it's going to end. It's going to end very, very shortly, Lawler. So when we climb in the ring, like I say, we're going to have a fight, and you're not going to win it. And I want you to fight with everything you got, because I'm going to fight with everything I got, and may the best man win. And that man's going to be me. By hook or crook, Lawler, I'm going to fight you with everything I got. Now, obviously, he didn't think it was important enough to come down for this television today. But I thought it was important enough, because I've been gearing for this, I've been training for it, and I know everything Jerry Lawler does in that ring. I've watched him time and time again. Every time Jerry Lawler's in that ring, I am watching him. And I'm watching what he does, and I've rode with him, I've talked to him. And it's not that I hate him. I just got that burning desire to beat him, and I know how he is. So I'm not stupid. And Lawler, when you climb in the ring, buddy, I want you to know, I want all the fans to know that I'm coming after that belt. I'm going to walk out of that Southern belt. Thank you.
Well, I'll tell you, it might be predictable just exactly like that, because Dutch Mantell, that same kind of straight-ahead approach that he's always had, and as we kind of had a feeling when those two get together, brother, it is going to be some kind of a bash. You can better believe that. I remember the previous ones that they had, Davey, and that was, man, it was something else to see. Okay, we got action coming up. Some of the families coming in just a moment. Ring with action right now. We want to take time out to bring a brand new face into championship wrestling. And we thought maybe there might be two of them, but I want to introduce all of our fans out there to a young gentleman that we have heard so much about. He and his brother, they're out of Montreal, Canada, Jacques Rougeau. We're delighted to have you here, Jacques, and we're looking forward to seeing you in the area.
Thank you very much. I'd like to, first of all, to say to the people here that something occurred to me lately, and it's not very enjoyable for anybody here as much as it is for me, because my brother was injured snow skiing up in north on his vacation just before we came here. But I do want to apologize to the people, because I know that they expected it. And for on the other side of it, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm probably going to go back and see my brother, because he's got a broken leg. And I'm going to go ahead and... but if it occurs to the gentleman that signed the contract for it, that I'd be very glad in the very near future to meet these gentlemen that are champions around here.
Yeah, Jacques, you had you and your brother Philip had a match scheduled for the Southern Heavyweight Championship, so obviously this pretty well takes it out of the picture with...
Well, you know, it's something that... I was on vacation in Miami, and my brother was on vacation in Montreal, and we just wanted to take a good rest, because me and my brother as a tag team, we had a very good record.
Oh, you got a great record. We've heard nothing but Jimmy Hart out here. This is not the time for the...
Pretty boy. I love that shirt. Look at it. Oh, hey, Bobby, look at the guy's shirt,
man. I'm going to ignore your comment, and I'd like to... apologize to you gentlemen, because we cannot be here to wrestle you. But like I said, I'd like to ignore what you just said, and I really like to apologize.
What's your name, Jacques Cousteau?
Jacques Cousteau?
All right, Bobby.
My name...
Try to see out that water, old dude.
My name...
See out that water.
My name is Jacques Rougeau, for your information, but I'm really looking forward to getting in that ring with you gentlemen.
Well, I've heard a lot about you and your old sister brother, and I've heard a lot about your old mama, and I've heard a lot about your daddy. I know that you're supposed to be a good tag team. Well, but where's your brother at? Is he scared? Is he redneck? Is he chicken?
Bobby, he just said he broke his leg in a skiing accident.
What was he doing? Pulling the anchor up for your old man? Chuck Cousteau, I know you're rated up high in the rankings for the tag.
Hey, come here, boy.
You're talking, man.
Don't
hey, come on now, fellas. Let's not start
it. Wait a minute, pretty boy. Relax. Wait a minute. Come here, Jacques Cousteau. Come here, Cousteau. Let me tell you, my friend. Look here.
Take it out of here.
We're still a tag team champions, my friend. Where's your brother at? Where's your brother at?
Right now, when my brother gets well and his leg gets well, I'm going to get in there with you and I'm going to wrestle you guys. I'm really looking forward to it.
But you signed him as the wrestler, you and your old sissy brother. Where's he at?
Where's how many that? Times you got to
hey,
tell you?
Is you laying on your mama? Hey, is you laying on top of your mama right there, brother? What you doing? You got a pacifier?
Oh, look,
come on, we saw the match. We saw the belt. Baby. Look at your paws, buddy. You're sharp looking guy.
Nothing on the floor down here. Now, you guys know better than that.
I'm going to tell you what now. I'm going to wait till my brother gets back. I'm going to wait till my brother gets back.
We don't want to wait. Why don't we get in the ring right now, sissy?
Yeah.
Let's get in the ring. Look at these belts.
I don't like to be called a sissy.
You don't like it when I just called you one.
Okay, Bobby.
You'll have your time when the time comes. When
come on, Jack Cousteau, let's get a ring now, my friend.
Hey, there's no time like now, baby. Come on, there's no time like now. Come on, Bobby.
Always agitate.
Just me, baby. Sugar. Look at that.
There's a robot.
Hey.
There's a robot. Would you keep this
one? Wait a minute,
Jack.
I'm going to get in the ring with you right now, big boy.
Where's your brother at?
Come on, Bobby. Now, either put up or shut up, and only one of you. Well, you guys come in here and start messing around with somebody. He told you he'd be...
We're going to show you what people in the South do now, baby.
We'll see what's going on.
Bobby Eaton in the ring with Jacques Rougeau. Rougeau, big, good-looking Canadian boy. He and his brother have quite a reputation. Jacques has his regular street pants on, his boots on. And he just slammed Bobby Eaton. Maybe he's going to get a little more respect. Oh, look at that. What a drop kick off the rope. Tremendous move from Jacques Rougeau. Rougeau slamming Sugar. Slamming hard. And now back with Sugar. Big backdrop. He's in the ring with three of them right at the moment. End of fight now. Yep, you might figure that you'd end up. You can't have the family in a fair and square battle anywhere. Here comes Terry Taylor, Stan Lane, Bobby Fulton, Eaton and Sugar and Hart out of it. Rougeau got up in the ring. Interference, fine. You got what you deserved in there. You all brought it on yourselves. Rougeau put Eaton down, and boy, I mean solid when he banged him with that drop kick off the second rope. And Jock showed he's living up to the reputation we heard about he and his brother. He got in there and he had some of the hospitality dished out by three of the family, which is exactly what you would expect out of it. Jock, we apologize for the interruption of the interview in there, but I got to tell you.
Well, like I said before, now maybe people understand that me and my brother were a good tag team, and we stand up for our name Rougeau in Canada, and I'm going to do it down here in Tennessee.
Okay, Jock. Let me give you back your ring and your thing. They were trying to horse off
with. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, we're delighted to see you here, and I'm tickled to death to see somebody do something like that flying drop kick that he did off the ropes and nail Eaton as hard as he did. We're going to take time out, and we're going to be back with more championship wrestling in just a moment. Still come, boy. We've had plenty of it right this very day here on Channel 17's Championship Wrestling Tonight out at the fairground. Goodness gracious, a Southern Tag Team title match. Sweet Brown Sugar and beautiful Bobby Eaton defend. For the very first time tonight, Southern Heavyweight title match. The King goes against the Dutchman. That one you got to see. Plus, of course, some other exciting matches. Terry, got a big one tonight for that Southern title, plus the personal aspect of it for you.
What goes... It is a personal thing. That's what it goes down to now. It's Jimmy Hart and his men and me. These guys go around trying to hurt my partners. They try to hurt me, but I just can't seem to get the job done. Wouldn't in wrestling like this, you can't take on three guys. One man can't do it. So I'm going to fight fire with fire. I've got a good partner in Jacques Rougeau, the man that's one that has the greatest name in wrestling up in Canada, Rougeau. I'll tell you, he can fight too when he has to. These guys are trying to break people's arms, take me out, take anybody else out. Well, Mr. Nice Guy's out the window. I'm telling you right now, people in Nashville, when you come to watch this match, you won't see any arm drags, you won't see any wrestling whatsoever. You're going to see a fight. If it takes both feet down in the gutter, go out the front door, it doesn't matter. Rougeau and Taylor are coming there to win and to take care of these three goose.
Jock, I think that you know already
from the experience that you had when we taped this show that the First Family doesn't believe in wrestling.
Well, you know what happens. I'm going to say, Mr. Russell, what happens. Now, I got a brother in the hospital up in Montreal because of an accident off a vacation. And I didn't need to come out there and I'll try to present myself the name Rougeau as a gentleman because it's already respected in this business. And I want to say just one thing now. The name Rougeau's going to be respected here because I'm not going nowhere. I'm going to settle some case with you. You act like big boys eating in cocoa. The black guy that's going around with the First Family. Well, I'm going to tell you something, big boy. You act like a big boy, you're going to be treated like a big boy. And I'm going to pamper you. You want to act like a baby, eh? I'm going to be looking after you. I need to take my word on that.
Tonight it's going to be some kind of double odd action. These two fine young athletes are going to be going against Eaton and Sugar. You've got to see them tonight. Is a fairground.
Taylor and Stan Lane in just a moment in our expiration of time match. And standing with me is the new entrepreneur of wrestling, Mr. Jimmy Cornette, who had signed the girls' champions, the U.S. Ladies' champions.
Ladies, that's exactly
what I said, as the first champion, Jimmy. What's new?
Well, Lance, as you know,
you're looking mighty dapper today.
Well,
I might
thank
say,
you
with
very
your,
much. My mother
your yatching hat on there.
Yatching? Okay. As you know, last week I signed the United States Ladies Champion, and now I have a rather startling announcement to make today, and I'm rather happy about it. I have, in addition to them, signed one of the most awesome individuals in professional wrestling today, a man who has held every title, every major honor that you can hold, and he is now, well, he soon will be the next Southern Heavyweight Champion, United States Heavyweight Champion, and the World Heavyweight Champion, and I'm talking about none other than the incomparable Dutch Mantell.
You have signed Mantell?
Because, you see, I have something that he needs. He needs to get a shot at Jerry Lawler, which he has, and he needs to win that Southern Heavyweight Championship. I can help him do that because I will be at ringside to assist him, not physically, now, mind you, but with my money, with my mind, and with my family name behind him for moral support. I will be at ringside this week, and I promise you he will take the Southern Heavyweight Championship from Jerry Lawler, because you see, Jerry Lawler, I still remember past several weeks when you came out here and you made fun of me, you humiliated me, you degraded my family name. I remember it, and I feel it right inside, and I promise you that when that match comes about and Dutch Mantell gets in that ring with you, then you're going to feel the same way that I felt. You're going to feel what I felt when I was standing here humiliated, because you're going to be standing there in the middle of that ring, if you can stand, and you're not going to have that belt around your waist, that thing that you love so preciously, and you heard Jerry Lawler with his big fat mouth that he runs people down with, you heard him say that that Dutch Mantell was the toughest man that he had ever faced. Well, he certainly is, and with me behind him, he certainly will be again. He'll take the title, and I will have the future World Heavyweight Champion, because that's all he needs to get that shot at Ric Flair, Lance.
Okay, Jimmy.
And if he does, he's going to get a very large bonus, because that's my dream, to humiliate Lawler and to get the World Heavyweight Champion under my contract, and I'm going to have them both in one man, the awesome Dutch Mantell.
Jimmy, I got to tell you, you were right. That was an astounding announcement in there. I am flabbergasted. I am surprised at Dutch signing a manager. But obviously you had something to offer him.
I had something to offer him, and I wrote it right out. I got it from my mother, and I wrote it right out.
Well, that's marvelous, Jimmy, and you have made our day with that
kind
of announcement.
Take the hand of the man that's going to manage the next World Heavyweight Champion, Lance.
Jimmy Cornette, who professes to be the man who is going to be managing the next World Heavyweight Champion. I am shocked. I can't say any more than that. He has gone out and bought him two pieces of merchandise and the ladies' champs and Mantell.
Champions, speaking of champions, Jimmy,
yeah,
stood out here. That's right, baby. I stood out and I said, you're going to be looking at the new world champions. And when Jimmy Hart says something, he backs it up, baby. Look at them, Dolls. Look at the audience, baby. Look at these people. You know, where we go, the people are saying, we want the Dolls. We want the Dolls. Well, let me tell you what, baby. We don't want you. Because when Jimmy Hart was laid up in that hospital bed, who sent me flowers and cards? Nobody. So don't try to jump on my bandwagon now, baby, with my Dolls. The world champions. You know, this is the greatest week for me in my life. The greatest week. You know, Mr. Bob Luce up in Indianapolis has been calling me every week. He's been saying, Jimmy, oh, Jimmy, would you please give my pretty little boys, my little
Spiky Hubert. The Young Lions is what they call themselves now, the Young Lions. And Stevie Regal, another shot at those belts. Please, will you come to Indianapolis and see what happened, man? See, they came down to Jimmy Hart's backyard. And when anybody comes in my backyard, baby, there's only one way out, and it's through me. And you don't go through me. So they lost the scraps here. So now every day, Bob Luce, tight pockets, money wad, man. I said, if you can come up with some bread, we might come back to Indy. We might come up there and make a tour. But I don't think if he took all the money in the whole state up there, if he took everybody up there in Indianapolis and put the money together, there's not enough to get the dolls back up there, man. Like I said, the Young Lions, you want us, baby? Then come and get us. You're looking at the world champions, boy. The New York Dolls, the greatest team in professional wrestling. So, Mr. Luce, Mr. Tight Pockets, if you want Jimmy Hart, come up with a scratch, baby, because you're looking at the world champions, baby, the world champions.
If we could just get them in a ring, we might be able to see how they're going to do today against Stan Lane and Terry Taylor. Jimmy Hart alienating the entire state of Indiana. And that's nothing unusual. Here come their opponents. Did you hear the kind of reception they get, Dave?
Yes, sir. This is going to be an expiration of time match coming up here, introducing at a total of 433 pounds. From Delray Beach, Florida, Stan Lane. From Barrow Beach, Florida, Terry Taylor. Going against them at a total weight of 479 pounds, the Dream Machine and Rick McGraw, the New York Dolls. Their manager, Jimmy Hart, is matched for the expiration of time, and Jerry Calhoun is the referee.
What a whale of a match, Dave, and we've got a little time on the clock up there, so we should see some great action in here. As Taylor and Lane, I've seen them a couple of times together, and boy, they really meld well together. Of course, Terry still misses Steve Kern, and in answer to you folks who have written, the letters have been passed on to Steve. Steve, we saw him over the weekend. He said his arm's coming along. He couldn't say a whole lot more than that. That was about it. All right. We're about ready to see action begin here, and here we go.
Stan Lane, the start against the Dream Machine. Dream Machine. Nails Stan with an elbow off the rope. Reversal by Stan. Down to the mat goes Dream Machine. And the Dolls back in the corner. Make a tag. Here's Rick McGraw. McGraw back under the rope. Center of the ring again. Stan Lane, Rick McGraw of the New York Dolls. There's a headlock by Stan.
Well, I knew you needed help over here.
Come on, Jimmy. No.
It's amazing. Everybody wants some Jimmy Hart's bandwagon now since I've got the world champions, but I don't need anybody. Where were they when I needed them? When I needed them, they wasn't behind me, so I don't need anybody now, baby. We're on top of the world.
Stan Lane fired across the ring. McGraw lets him go by. Stan sets himself. Drop kick. Stan Lane takes him over. There's the referee right there to start the count. But McGraw able to get the right shoulder up off the mat.
Don't worry, baby. Lane's doing the best he can do right now. Get it. Come on, baby. Come on, dog. You can get him, daddy.
Stan Lane hanging on. Terry Taylor, his partner, watching in the corner. The New York Dolls, Rick McGraw and the Dream Machine going again. Lane and Taylor. Stan over to the corner, makes the tag on Terry Taylor. Lane and Taylor, as Lance said earlier, we've seen them together a couple of times before. They make a good tag team. They have similar wrestling style.
A good tag team? You've got to be joking, man.
Terry Taylor with the arm. Rick McGraw. Put a little twist on it. McGraw looking toward the corner. He's a long way from the tag on his partner. Now a little closer. Did he get it?
Look at them. Lane and Taylor are preppies, man. They're valley boys. Look at them. They're worried about their muscles, their hair. Look at them.
Taylor makes the tag. Stan Lane coming back in.
With a fist. Did you see the fist? Tell me. Come on. Does it look like it is?
Yeah, I saw it.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
There's a tag made, and Terry Taylor is back. McGraw off the ropes, and Taylor nails him in the midsection.
Hey, you call him doll number two. That's what you call him, not McGraw. Come on, baby. Come on.
Taylor drops with the arm. Count of two.
Come on, baby.
And the New York Dolls make a tag. Dream Machine back in.
Come on, Dolly. You got him, baby. Come on. There you go. Look at that. What a good move, huh? Beautiful.
A drop by the Dream Machine. Terry Taylor picked up now. Reverses him. And the doll finds himself flying through the air.
Come on, Calhoun, wake up over there.
Tag made by Taylor and Stan Lane coming back.
Look, one man holds him. The other man drops on his arm. Did he not do that? Hey, Calhoun, wait a minute.
Stan Lane. Dragging the Dream Machine back, but Dream Machine threw him away to the rope. Stan steps over. Dream swings. Stan takes it down. And after all of that, Stan Lane still with the advantage over the New York Doll, the Dream Machine.
Three people. How can we fight the referee? And this is ridiculous. Come on, man. Another man.
Terry Taylor, after the tag, grabbed Dream Machine's arm.
Come on, Doll. Come on, baby.
Back to the Doll's corner. They make a tag. And they double team. As Terry Taylor is trapped in their corner over here. The New York Dolls, both have been working on him. Dream Machine steps back out now. McGraw pounded away at Terry Taylor. Jabbed him in his throat, it looked like. 4.5 minutes gone in this ball. 4.5 minutes gone. The Doll using the side of that boot and the laces. He raked it across Terry Taylor's face. Taylor kicked out at the count of one. As the Doll had almost had him set up, he thought at least, for a pin. Dream Machine back in there now for the Doll. Double hand. Drops down across the back. Going for the cover. Counts at two, but that's all he gets as Terry Taylor breaks out of it. Power slam. One, two. Stan Lane with an assist. And that stops at the count with two. For the Dolls, it's Rick McGraw. Taylor starting for the corner by a handful of hair. By McGraw stops his progress. He was not able to get the tag on Stan Lane. New York Dolls. Their world belts over here on the table. This is a non-title match, but they hold the belt. I think you can see some of the reasons why in this match. There's one of them right there. Foot to the midsection by the Dream Machine. Taylor off the rope, throws it down. One. Count stops at one. 6.5 minutes gone in this ball. Tag made by the New York Dolls. Shoulders down, and the referee got a two count before Terry Taylor was able to get out of it. Taylor,
he got a big one on him, Dave.
Boy, he does. Taylor reaching, I think maybe he was reaching for a tag, but he's turned around. The tag is on the other side of the ring, and he's got a long way before he can get there. Back on his feet. He drops, but Taylor had moved. The New York Giants make the tag. Here's McGraw. It's a one count. Rick McGraw for the New York Dolls. Terry Taylor. Fighting back. He needs to get to the corner. He does it. Here's Stan Lee. Lane rolling them both around the ring. Drop on the green machine. Draw lead. The Dolls make a tag, and McGraw's the man who's supposed to be in there anyway. Double clothesline. Terry Taylor jumps in.
It's going to be a disqualification, Dave. We're going to have to get out of here, and we'll check our time. Be back. Disqualification. The Dolls are going to win it.
Show today for as we get underway right here, we're going to take time before we get back in the ring to talk to Jimmy Cornette and Dutch Mantell. Jimmy.
Lance, I've got a special presentation I'd like to make today. As you know, Dutch has been with me now for a week, and I must say we've gotten to be quite good friends, and I wanted to present, if I could, if the cameraman can get a shot of this beautiful portrait of myself and Dutch as a token of my esteem and friendship to him for signing with me and being such a great champion that he is.
And it says to my good buddy, Dutchy Jimmy Cornette. Well,
you know, Lance, I'm really excited today. I haven't been this excited since I divorced my first old lady. But I am really excited today. And you know why I'm excited? Because this man here, he is a million legs. He's a laugh a minute. Being with this guy is like being at Chickie's Pizza 24 hours a day. And you know, a lot of people have said that Dutch, you and Jimmy Cornette, you just don't seem compatible. But I think the reason we don't seem compatible is that they just don't know a lot about Jimmy. And you know, he said we signed a contract last week. Well, in essence, we didn't sign it last week. And why didn't we sign it last week, Jimmy? Because I said we should do it on TV, on public television, so we could be up front with it and so people would think there's nothing under the table. And the people, I know we look funny. I know we look like John Wayne and Ted Turner out here, but you people go ahead and laugh because we're going to set the wrestling world on its head. Now, Jimmy, you know how I feel about certain things, and I think the reason the people may not like you so much is because they don't know how you feel about certain things, so I would like you to tell the people at home exactly how you feel. And I'm going to ask you a few questions. I want you to tell these people at home, okay, how you feel, okay? You got that? Jimmy, I'd like to ask you a question and tell the people, do you drink?
No, Josh, I don't drink.
See, he doesn't drink. See, he don't drink anything. Jimmy, do you like to stay out late at night and get thirsty and start fights or anything like that? Do you like to do that?
No, I try to stay in 10 or 11 at night at the latest.
See,
he don't
stay out late at night. He keeps regular hours. Right, Jimmy, a very important question. You don't take drugs or snort cocaine like them NFL football players do. You don't do that, do you?
No, I don't, Dutch.
See, he don't do any of that. He lives a clean life, right? You live a clean life. Jimmy?
Dignity.
You don't smoke or chew tobacco, do you?
No, that's a filthy habit.
See, he says that is a filthy habit. Filthy, filthy. Jimmy, I'd like to say one thing. You don't like to get up early in the morning and watch cartoons like Bugs Bunny or Yosemite Sam. You don't like to do any of that, do you?
I watch Richard Simmons in the morning when I get a
chance. He watches Richard Simmons. Now, you people have seen how compatible Jimmy and I are. And Jimmy, you got the pen.
Yes, I do, sir.
You got the contract.
This is a big day in my life, Lance.
Big day in your life, baby. Right here. Big, big day in Jimmy Cornette's life. Let me see that pen, baby.
We've got a public signing right here.
We've got a contract and a public signing, and this is the first step, Lance.
Jimmy, you see this pen?
Yes, sir.
Well, this pen could change your life. You know that? It could make you a very famous man. You know that?
I know that.
And with this pen, Lance, it's one small step for man, but one giant step for wrestling. And Jimmy, I'd just like to take this pen and break it like this, take your contract, and sign it up. And you are the last man in the world, buddy, that I would want to manage me. Because you here, take that and stick it where the sun don't shine. I want to tell you one thing, buddy. I made a mistake when I had you cut up. I made a mistake when I had you come out, but I'm man enough to say I made a mistake. And the only difference between me and Lawler is I'm not above, buddy, taking you for a few dollars, and that's what I did. You see this picture, Jimmy? You see this picture out here? Here, buddy.
That's your house right there. And this is mine.
Give this to me. I put a lot of money into you. I put a lot of money into you. I put a lot of money on him, man.
I'm afraid you've got some built-in problems with Dutch Mantell. He just fired you.
This is what Buddy told you. These jinks even fight amongst them, Buddy.
Yes.
Said they're stupid there. I got a word of advice for you. And this is what I want you to listen to, Yank. What you should do in your condition, you should go and take yourself some Tylenol and think about it again. Get the hell out of here.
Let me introduce to you, ladies and gentlemen. We've been expecting them, and now they're here with Championship Wrestling. These gentlemen are from New Zealand, known as the Sheep Herders.
Known as the Sheep Herders is right. In 37 different countries, we have held titles. Not just here in America. The one thing wrong with you stupid, bloody, stupid, septic tank yanks is you think America is the greatest country in the world. Well, we're here to show you that it's not. This is not a professional sport. This is a professional business, and we're businessmen. And all you bloody Yankee wrestlers, listen to me now, because it's just like if you open up a service station on the other side of the street from us, we do everything in our power to get you out of business. Now, we're not here. We're not bloody here to make friends with you, Yanks. We're here to hurt you. We're here to introduce you, Yanks, to bloody pain. And we are going to introduce you to so much pain. You're going to say pain is gain in the gym. You're going to run right to the gym, right to the doctor, anywhere you bloody want to run, but you will run. You will watch our matches. You will watch us hurt people. You will watch us bust arms. And you've already seen our film that we sent in here of us destroying so many Yanks one after another. We're here. We're the best. We're the meanest, the toughest, and we're going to hurt you, Yanks.
You're listening to Jonathan Boyd and his partner, Luke Williams, from New Zealand, known as the Sheep Herders, and we're going to see him in action in the ring in just a moment.
Team Championship Wrestling. By golly, what an interesting show today. And let me tell you about interesting. Tonight out at the fairgrounds, I said tonight out at the fairgrounds, the action is going to be good. Robert Gibson going against Carl Fergie. Bobby Fulton against the Angel. Buddy Landell and Dutch Mantell going against the brand new New Zealand Sheep Herders. And then the main event. Stand by for this one. Jimmy Hart, New York Dolls, will be engaged in a little fisticuffs with the brand new fabulous ones. You'll be hearing more about it in just a moment.
You know what? You have seen the rest, but now you are definitely looking at the best. The Touch of Class National is coming at you, Music City, USA. Let me introduce my men the way they should be introduced for you. Ladies and gentlemen, and I use that word very, very loosely, I present to you the greatest tag team in professional wrestling, the new world champions, my New York Dolls. Now you can take it back. Come on, tell them, bring it on, tell
them. That's what it's all going to be like. You know, that's Grand Ole Opry Town, what I'm saying. Funky, funky, funky. Graveyard disposition, a tombstone mine. Two big white mother sons that don't mind God. You know, I got my hat on cocky. Jackie Fargo, you think you the head muck honcho around Nashville, Tennessee. You got another thing coming. You bring your fabulous ones and come on down and get the New York Dolls. You understand what I'm saying? Because, baby, it's New York. You understand what I'm saying? Uptight, wanting to fight. Tell them what it's going to be like, Dolls.
That's why I roll up every street except for those leading to the fairground, because the only activity happening in the Music City tonight is going to be the New York Dolls.
Right.
Bring it down, bring it to the fabulous ones, they call themselves. Jackie Fargo, you better stay at home, because you're going to be embarrassed right there in Nashville, Tennessee, where the New York Dolls are the ones that will be wrecking with, Jack.
I think not only you, but the rest of the Hart group right here better stay around and just take a listen to what we got coming up on Championship Wrestling in there. Tonight, the New York Dolls and the fabulous ones. And I got to guarantee you this, it is going to be worth your trip, your admission, to get in to see that one battle on that tonight at the fairgrounds.
Yeah, you better believe that. What was the time again?
Time on it was 3 minutes 13 seconds.
3 minutes 13 seconds. The winner is the Sheep Herders over Fulton and Stark. We've got more tag action coming up in just a moment.
By golly, I'll tell you one that was a dandy. It was the New York Dolls defending the title against the guys they had won it from, Steve Regal and Spike Huber, and we've got it. Take a look at it.
official bell has sounded, and we're off and running on a sanctioned WWA World Tag Team title returned match between the former champions Spike Huber and Steve Regal against Jimmy Hart's New York Dolls. In the original one, Hart just got through dumping a barrel of powder, it looked like, right on Steve Regal, who was down at ringside, while Huber is up in the middle taking shots from both of the New York Dolls. The referee, Jerry Calhoun, had his hands full before it ever started. Regal and Huber were waiting on the Dolls, jumped out of the ring, took off after them, and chased them toward the back. Finally got back around ringside, but boy, I'll tell you, it has been nothing but havoc since that time. Regal pulled into the ring with a powder in his eyes. And the referee trying to get Huber back around to the corner and get a little order restored. Rick McGraw is on the outside. The Dream Machine just tagged to him. And McGraw comes in with Steve Regal and a whip across the ring, a big backdrop, and Regal is down hard. Spike Huber hollering at Steve, tag, tag. He's looking for a tag in so that the pressure of the two. And, of course, Steve still trying to clear those eyes up where Hart unloaded something on him. Tag again on the Dream Machine and the Dolls. Working closely as a team. Dream Machine. Turns Regal over, tags McGraw, and Rick McGraw comes in firing at Steve Regal. In actuality, this championship match is only a couple of minutes old. Big suplex from McGraw on Regal. One, two. Regal kicked out at the two. Reverse neck breaker, and Steve down on the deck, his face still white as he keeps daubing at his eyes, trying to get some more of that substance, powder or whatever, that Hart threw at him out of his eyes. Big elbow from the Dream Machine. And I guess maybe the only good thing you could say about the activity that's going on now, it gives Steve more time to try to clear those eyes up. Power slam from McGraw, and Regal just kicked out of it. And Jimmy Hart hollering at the referee about, where's your count? Where's your count? He thought that three count was a little on the slow side. Elbow from McGraw puts Regal down. Huber kind of pinned to the corner over there so that he can be ready in the event that Regal makes it over to him. Tag on the Dream Machine. The New York Dolls. The new WWA World Tag Champions. Regal goes in over and down with a big backdrop. Another whip. Shot to the neck from the Dream on Regal, and now a tag to McGraw. Rick McGraw and the Dream Machine. The New York Dolls. And McGraw, using that right fist, goes for a chokehold on the rope. And a typically Hart-trained team working on Steve Regal. They move in and out of the ring smoothly, but they'll violate every rule within a four-minute period. They cover about 90% of all the rules. And they're careful to be sure that they don't do it long enough to where the referee counts them out. But, of course, as champions, that's not going to hurt them in terms of losing the belt if they're disqualified.
5 minute mark with 55 to go, and Steve Regal, during the last 2 minutes and 30 seconds, has really taken a shellacking in the ring from the New York Dolls. And Regal with a foot puts the Dream Machine down, but he does not get to the corner to tag Huber. The Dream back on top of him, misses a double-handed shot, and once again, the Dream is down. Rick McGraw in now is Art at ringside, pacing and hollering. Big choke underneath the rope. And right at the disqualification count, McGraw breaks it. Huber rushes across the ring, and of course the referee sends him back as the Dream Machine steps down on the throat of Steve Regal. They are playing at KG. What a drop kick standing from Rick McGraw. He stood right there holding on to Regal's hair, jumped straight up and banged him good. On the second rope as he comes off with both hands on Steve Regal. Regal takes a right-handed shot from the Dream and another one. Disqualification on Huber. Ring the bell, and that's what it is, a disqualification on Huber and Regal for hitting the referee, throwing him. Nine minutes and 34 seconds. Another pile driver coming up, this time on Spike Huber. Disqualification has taken place. Regal and Huber lose it.
that disqualification. And now the New York Dolls really pouring it on Regal and Hubert. There's Karch Kane coming into play. Terry Taylor, Stan Lane. And the Dream Machine with that walking stick nailing Taylor, but good. Hart and Rick McGraw jumping on Stan Lane as he climbed through the rope. Coming right back after Rick McGraw. Both teams disqualified. The referee is telling us.
Blistering match, David, mm-hmm. Even after it was before it started and after it was over.
Right.
And it was action all the way. Hey, guess who's coming up next? The Fabulous One. We'll be to him in a moment. Fabulous Jackie Fargo, Dave. He and his brother still hold some attendance records in Boston and various places like that. Got an interesting segment here we want you to take a look at with the Fabulous Jackie Fargo.
Hi, wrestling fans. Certainly good to be back on this TV again. It's been some time, and it's been nice out playing golf and then doing a lot of things that I never got to do as a professional wrestler for 25, 30 years. Real exciting, boy, to get up in the mornings and knowing you don't have to jump on an airplane or jump in a car and go wrestle that night and jump in the car and drive back and drive another 800 miles the next day or get in the airplane with your sore body and your mind really not straightened out yet. It's been real nice, but I talked with my buddy Eddie Marlin. I said, Ed, you know, them days fishing and golfing's about over. I'm watching wrestling on TV and get a little itchy. And that's what I done. I got real itchy. I looked up on my TV and you know what I've seen? The worst imitation that I have ever seen in my entire life. Let me tell you something, Hart Pally. You don't know what a Fabulous Fargo is. You have no earthly idea. You bring two geeks, two guys that you picked up off the street, and you want to make them Fabulous Dolls from New York. You can forget that, Hart. Let me tell you something, pal. You're a joke and they're a joke. What do you buy? A $2 bottle of dye, put it on their hair, and buy them a $25 tuxedo. Let me tell you something, Hart, you punk, and your two little guys from New York. I sweated many a gallon of blood and sweat to be a professional wrestler, and I'm damn proud of it. And there's only one Fabulous Fargo from New York, Pally. That was me and Donnie. The pictures you see with the tuxedos, the high hats, the original Fabulous Fargos, and a punk like you, Hart, you're going to come along and steal something that I built up all of my life, that I put my pride and my glory in, something that brought me fortune and fame, Hart. Well, you stink, boy. You stink. Now, I'm going to give you some good advice. I promised Eddie Marlin I wouldn't cuss and raise too much cane on his TV, but I can't help it. You stink, Hart. You're too synthetic. New York of dolls. What a joke. Let me tell you something, pal. If there's going to be any fabulous ones around, if there's going to be any high hats around and tuxedos around, it's going to be first class, and it's going to be who I pick. Not who you pick, Hart. You stink. You stink. You got nothing about you, pal. $25 tuxedo. What a joke. My socks cost more than that, Pally. When I walked around with the top hat on, with the gloves and the sequins, they cost something, boy. They didn't cost 25 cents. You're disgusting. You're disgusting to me. To think what I've put in the wrestling business and you want to come along with this. Well, let me tell you something, Pally. I went out and got me a couple of guys. Tough. That's what you don't have, Hart. You gotta be tough. You gotta have a heart. You gotta have a heart as big as a watermelon, not big as a peanut, like you and them two geeks you got. Well, Pally, I got me two wrestlers. And I'm gonna put the high hats, and I'm gonna put the tuxedos on them. But you know what they can do that your boys can't do? They can fight. They're tough. And if you slap them, you know what they'll do to you? They'll slap the hell out of you. They're going to do that. You're not going to smack them upside the head and walk off and prance around. Time you get your fist back from their jaw, by gosh, you're going to have one upside of your head. That's the only way it's going to be with me, pal. I'm back. The fabulous Jackie Fargo's back. Not as a manager, as a consultant. I'm going to advise these two men. And when I say men, I'm talking about men. Tough, rugged, fighters. That'll kick your teeth in, Hart. You better not show up there. You better not show up in the arena with your boys with no tuxedos on and no high hats. You cannot go around imitating me, Pally. I will not give you permission to do that. You have no right, and you have the audacity of you. You little stinky stink. You stink. I got pride. I'm saying this to you right now. I am out of retirement. I want to fight. I want to feel. I want to touch. I want to beat. I want to claw and scratch and dig. That's what I'm known for, and that's what I'll die for. And I'm tough. Don't you forget that, Hart. And don't you boys forget it either. Trying to imitate the fabulous Fargos, you ain't got a chance. I got two of the greatest men that I've ever seen. They're the ones that's going to wear the tuxedos. They're going to wear the top hats. And yeah, they'll be doing the Fargo strut too, pal. And I'll be proud of them. I'll be proud to say, look at that. Look in the wrestling ring. Look. I look back 25 years ago. I see me and Donnie. They're going to get out there and they're going to give some people some hard times, pal. I'm not going to be running around like you, Hart, with a stick and my manager's hat and all that. I don't need it. But I'm going to be the advisor. I'm going to be the consultant. And I tell anybody, I don't care who it is, you must know this in the wrestling, as a professional wrestler, when you climb in that ring, you don't have friends. I don't care who they get in the ring with, or where, what city. If they ever do not take my advice, then I'll back away from them. But I think I've got the team that wants to be the fabulous ones again. And I'm looking forward to it. And I'm telling you again, Hart, don't bring your boys with them little $25 suits on. That's all I got to say, Pally.
new force to be felt, the fabulous one, from the fabulous one. By golly, we got some action in the ring. We're going to be back to it here in just a few minutes. Because tonight is tonight, right out there at the fairgrounds in Son of a Gun. You don't want to miss the opportunity to see Robert Gibson against Carl Fergie, Bobby Fulton going against the Angel, Buddy Landell and Dutch Mantell going against the New Zealand Sheepherders. It'll be your first time. They really get in there and watch these.
Imitator!
Jam!
Oh, come on, man! Imitator, let me tell you something, Jackie Fargo. Why don't you take this quarter, baby, and why don't you call somebody who cares if you come back into professional wrestling or not, baby? Let me tell you something. You want to show pictures of blood and black eyes? Hey, Jimmy Hart's been down that road too, Pally. Pally, Pally, I hate that word, Pally. If he said it again, I'd blow my brains out. Well, let me tell you something, Pally. I've had the black eyes, and I've had the scars on my head, and I've been in the hospital with a broken leg, and I've had the fractured jaw too, Pally. Where have you been for 3 years? I'll tell you where you've been, getting those social security checks, boy. Well, this is professional wrestling now. 1982, not 1952, baby. The exos are out, Fargo. They're all gone. Music City's our town. Let me tell you something. It's still Steve Kern and Stan Lane, but with beards. Why have they got beards? Because the First Family has them. Because, you see, they are followers. They're not leaders. So, Fargo, why don't you call somebody that gives a care? I promise you one thing.
That's right, Jackie Fargo. I'd have been ashamed, man, to get up here on that film and show my skunk head. You better take $2 if you so-called call it and buy you some bleach, boy. You understand what I'm saying? You're going to make one of the probably the biggest mistakes that you've ever made in your fat, stinking life, you understand what I'm talking about, because I'll tell you why, Fargo. I'll tell you exactly why. You should have stayed on that golf course, because the wrestling business is no place for you now, and it's no place for you, Stan Lane. It's no place for you, Steve Kern, because we're going to show you a lesson. You understand what I'm talking about? I see a lot of dirty days done dirt cheap, and I know, Fargo, that you've done a lot of them.
All right, that's it. The New York Dolls, the fabulous ones, tonight, right out there at the fairgrounds. We'll see who the imitators and who the leaders
Light
and followers
the fragile,
are.
Fargo, Light
all right,
oh,
tonight's
baby.
The one. You better be out there and see it, too.
It's into the match, and Jerry Lawler is severe trouble. Uh-oh, down on the floor. Look out. Lawler slammed into the ring post. And Nick Bockwinkle is using the street tactics that he certainly has no objection to using when it comes to holding a title or winning one. Referee Jerry Calhoun comes down to chase Bockwinkle off. Nick hops up nimbly into the ring. I'm not sure whether he's going to get up out of this. He's got a 10 count. The challenger comes over and looks at him. But Lawler, a game one, who has known adversity before and battled his way back, trying to get up off the floor. And Nick Bockwinkle too close to the ropes, and the referee trying to back him up as Lawler comes under. Bockwinkle meets him with that foot right in the middle of the back and the back of the neck. Lawler battling his way back up. The first one of the night. A second one. Bockwinkle stunned. He's on the canvas, but quickly back up. Walks into a left. The referee hollering, open the fist up. And a right hand slides Bockwinkle into the center of the ring. Waller, one, two, and he can't get the third one. Thought he had it, but he didn't. Looks like a suplex. Slamming Nick Bockwinkle into the canvas. Lawler now covers him. One, two, and Bockwinkle slides out. The right. Turnbuckles, Lawler again with a right hand. Jerry Calhoun, the referee, continues to say, open him up. But he's not getting a respect in that regard from either of the wrestlers when they had the opportunity. Oh, boy. He staggered him back into the turnbuckles. Bockwinkel slumping in the corner. Lawler right on top of him. A lesser man would have been gone already. A reversal. As Bockwinkel slings Lawler down, and down goes referee Jerry Calhoun. Oh, he fired Lawler in. Lawler at 234. Calhoun weighs about 160 pounds. With Calhoun down, Lawler goes to the corner. Bockwinkel in the center of the ring. The crowd hollering, be careful, Jerry. And Bockwinkel rolled out of the way. Lawler right on the spine. Pile driver. Lawler hurt. Bockwinkel going for a cover. One, two, three, and he got him. Ladies and gentlemen, a new Southern champion in 24 minutes and 1 second, Nick Bockwinkel.
Yeah, it was kind of a discouraging thing, I know, for Jerry in that particular instance in there, but as we said, he's had adversity before. We're going to take time. I'll be back in just a moment. Thursday night, not tonight, you're going to see in action Jerry the King Lawler against Crusher Broomfield as Jimmy Cornette will be making his debut in the corner, and then you're going to see Sugar and Eaton going against Jacques Rougeau and Terry Taylor. More on that in a moment.
Well, let's
Jimmy.
Talk about Crusher. My debut in Crusher's Corner, Lance.
That's true.
Is going to be Jerry Lawler's final appearance in Nashville, Tennessee. I can promise you that, because the biggest obstacle that I've had to put up with trying to get into professional wrestling is Jerry Lawler, his big fat mouth running people down and trying to get me out of it. And I promise you, when Crusher Broomfield comes to town, 400 pounds, 6 feet 10, he drops on Jerry Lawler, it's going to feel like a house with a three-car garage. And that's going to be the end of Jerry Lawler's glorious reign as King of Nashville, Tennessee. Because everybody thinks he's the king down there. Well, if he wants to come down there and all his fans want to stagger in to see it, I can promise you it'll be his last appearance in Nashville, Tennessee. You don't have to worry about that. And from now on, Crusher Broomfield is going to be known as the king around here, and I am going to have my way in professional wrestling, Lance.
Well, we'll find out what kind of batting average he's going to have right here. Jimmy Hart, Sweet Brown Sugar.
You know, I can't believe this. Everywhere we go in Nashville, people are saying, boy, y'all are running from Jacques Rougeau and Terry Taylor. Hey, these guys have never run from anybody in their lives. Let me tell you exactly what happened, baby. We went to the ring, right? We came back from the ring with the belts, and all of a sudden, these guys are going, we got to do this, we got to do that. Chasers out the back door. We couldn't even catch these guys, and now they want a title shot. These men put the belts up 52 weeks a year, 7 days a week. So we want a little rest, right? Now they're coming in acting like big shots. But let me tell you something, big shot, Mr. Jacques Rougeau. Hello, pally, big boy. I'm going to tell you something, Daddy. If you can pin these guys in the middle of that ring, if you can get a pin on them, then maybe we'll sign a contract with you. You understand what I'm saying? Tell them, sure.
You ain't seen nothing yet. You just wait and see. You want to get a little funky, we're going to get funky. You just be there. I guarantee you, we're going to get down now, Pop.
Well, it's going to be a non-title bout. That means nobody has to worry about it. That means that Taylor and Rougeau may let it loose coming Thursday night.
All right, going to be back to Channel 17's Championship Wrestling in just a moment. Let me give you the card tonight, right out there at the fairgrounds, my friend. Landell going against Robert Gibson. Then it'll be Bobby Fulton against Carl Fergie. Listen to this one. It's signed since this show, and you'll want to see it. The Sheepherders going against Dundee and Mantell. And then the main event, the fabulous ones, Jackie Fargo against Jimmy Hart's New York Dolls. But no time, no disqualification.
Hey, Pally. Hey, Pally, it's me, man. No time. You're living on borrowed time already. No time, Jackie. Remember it. Life is fragile, Mr. Fargo. Handle it with care.
We'll be looking for it. That's tonight out at the fairgrounds. A lot of hilarity going on. That won't be the call one that comes up tonight out there. Jonathan Boyd, Luke Williams, the Sheepherders. You'll see in just a moment what brought about this bout with Dundee and Mantell.
For 18 months, we've been planning to come here, Dundee. When you are sitting down thinking about this, ask yourself why. Why should the number one team in the world come here just to destroy soft, bloody Yanks, Dundee? There's got to be a reason. Got to be more than one reason. You're going to be one of them, and they're going to find out in Nashville. As the people in Nashville have seen, nobody can even come near us. Because you know why? Yanks don't like pain. Anybody wants to become a professional wrestler has to inflict pain with their knowledge. Pain is what makes men move. When you grab hold of them, you can feel them move. And Dundee, we're going to be moving you and your bloody Yankee partner, Mantel, all over the arena.
I'll tell you one thing for a fact. Tonight, there's going to be a whole lot of personal going down when they get together. The Sheepherder's going against the superstar Bill Dundee and his partner, Dutch Mantel. And don't you believe that, by golly, that won't be some kind of a battle. That'll be followed up by the Dolls going against the Fabulous One, No Time, No Disqualification. Big night to be out at the fairgrounds and join us. Jackie Fargo's Fabulous One. Deep Current, Stan Lane. Let's take in a little of this right now. Fern and Lane making their first live appearance here on Championship Wrestling. This coming under the consulting team of Jackie Fargo. Team, okay, baby.
Don't come up here so close.
I'm sure glad you did. Charles Fergie giving a little static in there about the knock off all the showbiz. Fergie a little upset that the attention is all on the team of Lane and Kern. A couple of specimens, Dave.
What's this man's
focus? All right, man, we got our eye on him. We will be to it in just a minute. Take long is what Steve Current says. Let's have the introduction for this match, Dave.
It's one fall, 15-minute time limit match. Total weight of 435 pounds from Atlanta, Georgia. Carl Fergie, and from parts unknown, the enforcer, going against him at a total of 443. The Fabulous One, Steve Current and Stan Lane. One fall, 15-minute time limit. Jerry Calhoun, the referee.
Fergie now, after being irate about that, it's a little ironic. He hadn't even taken his jacket off, so he goes through the procedure to get rid of his jacket. He had a little front-center spotlight while we were waiting on him. Stan or Steve, one of them's got to head out, same way with Carl Fergie and the Invader. It's the first time since Steve's arm phones were chipped in today that we've had him back.
That's right. Back today with Stan Lane, his partner. It's the enforcer starting against Stan Lane for the Fabulous One. Enforcer back to the rope. Stan pulls back to right there. Sees the, wait a minute. I'll do it. Nails him with a forearm. The strut by the Fabulous One. Carl Fergie and the enforcer. Conference with the referee. Stan Lane stays in here. Fergie steps back out in his corner. Fergie talking to the enforcer. Stan the center of the ring. Wrapped up the enforcer by the left arm. Over to the corner, the tag on Steve Kern. Steve in with the boot. The enforcer makes the tag on Carl Fergie. Kern, smiling, waiting, center of the ring. Fergie goes for a headlock. Steve Kern forces it back to the rope. On the rope, the referee wants a break. Fergie breaks it. Steve Kern traps him on the chest and backs away. Fergie fired into the rope. Oh, nails Kern coming off of there. Dropped with the upper arm. But Kern had moved. Fergie didn't move. He got a right hand. The knee of Stan Lane over in the corner. Stan Lane takes over after the tag. Fabulous one. Boy, what a team. What a bust by Stan Lane. Ducks under a haymaker swing by Carl Fergie. Held onto the rope. And there he gets the strut. The fabulous one. Feeling good after outsmarting Carl Fergie. Lane. The left arm. Fergie with a forearm across the face, but back in the corner, and Lane makes the tag. Now he's got Fergie tied up there. Steve Kern grabs it. Monkey flips him out of there. Fergie, body slam. Kern drops with the upper arm. The cover. One count only. Steve Kern, headlock on Carl Fergie. Back to the corner. Tag made on Stan Lane. Fabulous one, tagging in and out frequently. Fergie had to force Lane back into his corner. He's got him here. He tags the enforcer. The enforcer goes to the rope. Stan Lane not there. And the enforcer arrives, so the enforcer runs head on into partner Carl Fergie. We're 4 minutes into the action. 4 minutes gone.
Steve Lane and Kern, the fabulous one. Jackie Fargo has taken a couple of really fine athletes. He's pumped in some of that Fargo spirit to him, and boy, I'll tell you for a fact, he's really got a good-looking team here, baby.
Boy, that is indeed a fact. Fergie jumping up and down on the stomach of Stan Lane. Picks him up in the air now. Body slams him. There's a cover by Fergie. Stan threw him back at the count of one. Lane into the rope. Fergie back high in the air. Fergie made the tag on the enforcer. The enforcer comes in to try to take over where Carl Fergie left off. Stanley reaching for a tag. Steve Kern was on the other side of the turn post. When he got the tag, he grabbed the enforcer, knee drop, and a count of two and three. That's it. Teamwork with a capital T there from the fabulous one. As Stan Lane reached around for the tag, Kern was on the other side of the ring post, but he quickly moved around the post, got the tag, and then went around behind the enforcer. Stan Lane released to Steve Kern. He dropped him down, got the count of 3:05:02, the win for the fabulous one.
Well, I'll tell you, in a good win it was indeed. Hey, do you think, Dave, if we put on these top hats, they would kind of do the same thing for us as done for the boys?
Somehow I doubt it, too.
You know, the thing about this team that's unbelievable is that you stop and think the longer they go, the more dominant they can be because both of them are in such incredible condition. The fabulous ones. We got more action coming up, and we'll be back to it in just a moment. Oh, Sugar coming up in a moment. But before we get to it, want to bring out the superstar, Billy Dundee. By golly, I'll tell you, it's been a long time since, hey, Bill, really good to have you back here. We have missed seeing you in action right here on Championship Wrestling, and I bring that from all the wrestling fans.
Well, I thank you, Lester. Now, the last 5 weeks since the superstar ain't been here, I have heard all kinds of stories what happened to me. Now, I'm here in living color to tell you what happened, folks. Now, just listen to this. No, this is a true story. Somebody said I fell off my horse. Somebody said I wrecked my motorcycle. Somebody said I got drunk and fell down. Well, brother, I'm here to tell you what happened. 5 weeks ago, I was working out in Nashville, Tennessee, and I walked out the gymnasium. And there were four of the biggest gorillas you ever seen in your life, man. They were 9 feet tall. So one of them wanders up to me and says, hey, are you Bill Dundee? So I looked up at him and I said, yeah, I'm the superstar, Daddy. What you want? So what I want, he went, whack. So what a fight we had, man. Them four heads spitted, one and fried, mad, the other one, Jack. Now, just a minute. I got this bone broke, but you should have saw the other guy, man. There wasn't a mark on him. Now, that's what happened to the superstar, Daddy. So, that set
you look,
record.
You look like great, feeling great. Right. Yeah.
Now, I don't know what... Jonathan Boyd.
Come on, now. I thought we settled
you. Shut up. I want to talk to somebody I know. Billy Dundee. I don't believe it. The Scotsman that came to Australia and couldn't make it. When he couldn't be an Australian, what did he do? He left Australia and came to America where he knew the competition was tough, where he knew all the Yanks were dirt and rubbish. So what'd he do? Here he is. Billy, where have you been, Billy Dundee? Where have you been?
Can I just a minute. Let me tell you a little story. I've known this guy about 10 years, and I've known
don't
this
call
guy
me
about...
Guy. We're hey, not Americans. We don't use the terminology
okay,
guy.
Just. Okay, I know this bloke about 10 years, okay? That suits your ego, brother.
That's
okay, now let me tell
that.
You something. When George Barnes
get
and I come here off. 7 years ago, we was just like you. We had a little chip on the shoulder because we didn't drive around an air-conditioned car.
You would have to have chips on your shoulder just to hold your coda.
Johnny, the people are real nice to you. All them folks are real nice people. And if you give them half a chance,
if they're nice people, you tell me this. We've been to 37 different countries, and in every toilet we've been in, there's been a little sign that says, go home, Yank. Don't you go away. I want to talk to you. I've come here to talk to you, Dundee. I walked at you. Shut up and listen to me.
No, I ain't shut up.
You are a disgrace not only to Scotland, you are a disgrace to Australia. You grew up down under. You came here, and now you're trying to be a bloody Yank. Look. Cowboy, get back here.
It was plenty exciting. A fellow that comes in at about 378 pounds. Crusher Broomfield was the challenger for the Mid-America heavyweight title. Let's look at some of that action.
Mantell still being pounded, but fires a right hand back. And Broomfield shovels him into the rope. Big elbow, and down he goes. From the ropes, and Dutch got out of the way. Dutch would have been a grease spot if he'd have hit on top of him. Eight minutes into it, Mantell making a move here. shoulder, but boy, I can tell you. He paid for it as he bounced right down on his back. He, in fact, knocked Crusher off his feet. Cornette flipped a chain in as the referee was reading the riot act to him, but Dutch picked it up and he nails Brillfield. 1, 2, 3. And Dutch fires it back to Cornette. So the winner is still the Mid-America champ in 8 minutes 50 seconds. Thankful to the help from a chain that Cornette threw in, Dutch Mantell still the champion. Won it in 8:57 as he rattled Broomfield with that chain that Cornette had thrown in intended for Broomfield.
Well, there it is. Did you say thank you to Jimmy Cornette?
I said thank you very much, Jimmy, for helping me win this match. I thought he couldn't be a benefit to me, but I was wrong. He was a lot of benefit to me. Now, one thing, when you get in the ring with a man like Crusher Blackwell, he's 400 pounds in his heart. Wait a minute.
How come you talk to him and you don't want to even talk
because
to him?
Because he's scheduled right here.
Well, I'm scheduled. We were scheduled. Our name was on the bloody book.
250 miles, they come.
You know, that's what I hate about you bloody Yanks. You got no class at all. We've been champions in 37 different countries.
37?
And here you are talking to a piece of nothing.
He
a piece of bloody Yank
right now that
champion of what?
Of what? Title.
Hey, let me say something.
You want the interview?
Of course we want
you
the
want
bloody
the time?
Interview. What do you
hey, baby. Hey, baby, you got the time. You take it all you
now,
want.
There is a smart bloody Yank. There's a streak of yellow up his back a mile long, but that's a smart bloody Yank. Now, we have got something to say to you, Yank. We have come to this country to tell you one thing and one thing only. We ask you, Yank. And you bloody haven't got a wrestler out there that can come anywhere near the New Zealand sheep herder. For once and for all, you're going to be caught with pain as you think of it.
Dutch Mantell went and got his sidekick, the old Texas Justice.
Maybe they didn't want the time enough. Maybe they didn't want this time after all. But I was dumb enough to give it to him, right? Those guys are getting heat with me, and they're making me hot.
Oh.
But I'm going to tell you what, I can't fight too. They're not going to jump me like they jumped Dundee. Because I was born at night, but not last night, baby. They want into me. They know where I am.
Dutch Mantell, and the Dutchman has got a big title defense coming up. We're going to take time out. We're going to be back to it in just a moment.
It's going to be some big action, particularly two tag matches. Bill Dundee, Dutch Mantell against the Sheep Herders, and then a no time, no disqualification, Jimmy Hart's New York Dolls face Jackie Fargo's Fabulous One, Steve Kern and Stan Lane. Billy, I want to talk to you about this bout now with the Sheep Herders coming up. Boyd and Williams. Now, you knew them before down in Australia. They came out here and tried to make you look like a fool.
That's right. Let me tell you something, Johnny Boyd and Luke Williams. Dirty Dutch Mantell didn't get his name but run around kissing little girls and shaking hands with all old men, old ladies, brother. He got it because he could fight, and I'm glad he's on my side. And I'm going to tell you two guys something. We live there, right there in Music City, USA. That's the superstar's hometown. That's Mantell's hometown. And you're not coming over there to make no reputation. They come here the same chip on your shoulder, brother, that Barnes and Dundee come with. And it took some bloody Yank to knock that off, and we're going to knock it off your shoulder, Johnny Boyd and Luke Williams. Dutch Mantell have his whip at ringside, Jack, and you're going to feel what it is to be in the other end of it.
Well, I know one thing for a living fact. That is going to be a scrap and a half, a double tough match. When Jonathan Boyd and Luke Williams, the Sheep Herders, get in there and tangle in the ring, not on the studio floor like you'll see in just a moment or two, but right there in the ring with Bill Dundee and Dutch Mantell. And then it's the Fabulous Ones and the Dolls. Jackie Fargo had some very interesting conversation to say about those fellas.
Congratulations, Hart. Congratulations. You're still the number one idiot in the whole wide world. As the time gets nearer and nearer, I look up on TV and I see your little cheap imitation, stupid-looking little 25-cent hats and $2 coats. I don't like you, and I don't like what you've done to me and what you have tried to imitate. You're not as good as I am. You're not as good as my boys. You don't have any boys as good as mine. And I am not going to tolerate you. I'm going to stomp your brains out.
The Dutchman coming back in. And boy, I'll tell you what, he is ready for business. I think the Sheep Herder just stormed him up. He is going against a guy that was a former holder of this very title, eh?
Exactly. King Cobra.
This match is going to be to the expiration of time. Now, it is a championship match, but by special agreement for television, it will be a match to the expiration of time. Introducing the challenger from Memphis, Tennessee, at 233 pounds, King Cobra. And the champion defending his Mid-America title from Oil Trough, Texas, at 224 pounds, Dutch Mantell. The Mid-America Championship is on the line. It's a match to the expiration of time. Jerry Calhoun, the referee.
Ready for bell time, and here we go. Dutch Mantell, King Cobra, and this will be a dandy of a match in there. I'm sure that Cobra is a little disappointed that there isn't totally more time in this championship match in there, because a lot of the guys have the feeling that when they have sufficient amount of time, ultimately their opponent's going to make some kind of mistake that will turn it into a win. It could apply to both guys, so you make the judge as to whether it has any advantage for any particular wrestler. The Dutchman back in the corner, a tough guy. King Cobra outweighs him. That's nothing unusual. Both of them very quick. You saw an example of Dutch's ability to get around that ring, and he can really go. Cobra trying to feel him out and get a handle on him. Goes for a leg dive, and he misses it. So they both have got plenty of speed to burn in there, and this will be a dandy with the Mid-America belt on the line. Referee Jerry Calhoun, front face lock. Cobra hanging into the Dutchman. Dutch trying to straighten up and back it around. Takes him to the rope, and that's as good as you can get. That'll call for a break.
Best way to get out of that one, because Cobra also had the arm hooked, and Dutch is going to have a rough time working his way out of that there any other way.
Just wheeled him around, bounced him into the ropes, and the referee called for the break in there. We're in the Mid-America Championship action. Cobra this time going down with the leg, has Dutch on the deck with that leg locked up. He's taking it back to the outside as best he can, but Dutch eliminated some of that by hooking him around the chin, underneath the ropes, and that'll call for break. Back up and ready to go one more time. Dutch Mantell rushing out of that crouch position straight at the Cobra. And once again in the ropes, referee Calhoun saying, come on, let's break it up now. Not a clean break. Dutch flips over and Cobra runs into the top turnbuckle. Dutch hooks the chin to pull it away and pulls back on the shoulder, putting an extended amount of pressure going down the left side of that neck in there as Cobra, rugged. Excellent action.
Dutch taking the offensive there. He had been reacting to moves that Cobra had made pretty much on the defensive during the match so far, but now he's the one that's going for the hold. He's the one that has Cobra down on the mat.
Arm back up in the hammer position, Dutch hanging on to it, and Cobra trying to work his way back up. It kind of puts the necessity for Cobra really to go for a pin hold quickly because of the amount of time that's involved in it. That's another aspect of it, that whenever the time is shortened on a championship match, it's to the advantage, I guess you'd have to say, of the champion. Cobra, beautiful, flipped him and got a one count out of it. Dutch right back on top of him. He gets a one count. Cobra takes him out, and man, let me tell you, they really were going after it. Cobra went straight over the top, and Sunset flipped him back into a pin position, Davey. Got a one count. The Dutchman, before they hardly rolled out, was right back into it, pulled Cobra down. He got a one count out of it. So they are scrambling hard, and King Cobra, trying to take advantage of what time left, went for the pin. Was not successful, but a whale of a try, I'll tell you that. Cobra moving that arm around. Has Dutch now at a disadvantage. But Dutch still on his feet. Anytime that's the case, you can better believe he's got lots of action in store for you. Cobra winding him up a little more. Dutch comes straight at him to take him back to the corner, and that'll end up with a break being called by the referee. Cobra reluctant to let go of the arm. Dutch hanging on to that chin, and finally a break. And temper is getting a little short between King Cobra and Dutch Mantell with the Mid-America belt on the line. One, two.
Kind of a pushing and shoving match with the feet and then the hands. Referee in between them. Dutch was complaining about the slow break over on the rope.
Yeah,
that's the second
right.
time in the match that's happened, and Dutch unhappy about it, registering that complaint with the referee.
He bars that arm and pulls him right up into a position where he is able to get a little bit more leverage on it. The only thing that it puts Cobra a little closer to being up, he's on his feet, and of course one of the things that he can do when he is up is be able to move around behind and reduce the pressure from that bar. Dutch changes position and really steps over. Now he's working it down. Cobra has himself in a position where he looks like he's going to go to grab those legs, scoop it out, and pitch him forward. But Dutch, as he said, he was born at night, but not last night. And he moved his way out of it. And as Cobra went for the big hip toss, Dutch put on the brakes and leaned back, took that arm straight back on him, and King Cobra still having to feel his way around and see if he can find something he can get the tough Dutchman down into a pin position with. The likelihood of getting a submission on him is pretty like slim and none, as they say.
Yeah, that's one of those rare things when you get a submission on Dutch. We are very close to the six-minute mark. 5 minutes, 55 seconds gone in this championship match. First ball goes to the expiration of time.
We still have some wrestling time left, but we're looking at about 3 minutes, something like that. And Cobra need a midsection, and he puts Dutch down on the deck. So as we wind down very close, yeah, there's the official three-minute call on the expiration of time, right. And Cobra, with that reverse face lock on him, from this position, you can drop if you can get that wrist bone buried in up under that ear, cut off that circulation and go into a sleeper hold on it. But he is really squeezing down on Dutch Mantell. King Cobra takes his hand away from the rope as he is trying to get him in a position. I suspect, Dave, he's trying to get him in position more in the center of the ring, where if he does get a pin on him, he's not going to have the chance of the foot going over the rope. Back to the feet. Cobra takes a shot, and the Dutchman comes back with another, and Cobra exchanging with him. Mantell goes into front face lock and really caught him with an uppercut broad arm. 2 minutes to go in the action. 2 minutes of the expiration of time, and Dutch.
The match has been stopped. It's not a disqualification on anybody. It's a stopped match.
Chief Herder's Jonathan Boyd on the right there, and Luke Graham, who just put a pile driver on King Cobra. They have been in our hair all day long, but at least they haven't been in the extent that they're in Cobra and Mantell. Shoulder in, and Luke comes over. Did I say Luke Graham? Luke Williams.
Luke Williams, yeah.
Did, yeah. And Jonathan Boyd, the Chief Herders, with Dutch's whip right around Mantell's neck. Here comes the superstar. Hop out of there in a hurry, kicking Cobra on the way. And Dundee, Johnny on the spot when Dutch needed him. As he ended up, there's Cobra on the floor and Dutch in the ring. And Mantell, who had that whip wrapped around his neck in there, Luke Williams wrapped him up in it. And Billy trying to help him out as promoter Eddie Marlin and referee Jerry Calhoun helped Cobra out. The Sheep Herders, who have been a pain in the ear all day long, came in, jumped it. The referee stopped the match. And Cobra loses his chance at the title. Dave, we're going to have to take...
In just one moment, going to be looking for action in there that'll have young Jesse Barr in. And speaking of Jesse, here he comes along with manager Jimmy Cornette. Before we see Jesse in the ring, we'll have him out here. Jimmy,
Lynn, good day. I wish I wish that you had been there. It was fantastic.
What was this?
Dutch Mantell, when he wrestled Jesse Barr. I will be greatly surprised, ladies and gentlemen, if Dutch Mantell ever shows his face in public again, because I told you last week, Jesse Barr is the greatest professional athlete in the world, and he proved it, because... Lance, I'm telling you, Mantell, every time that he would try to do something, Jesse would he'd go back to that Olympic training, he'd counter it, he'd reverse it. Every time that Jesse did something, Mantell was hopeless. He couldn't cope with it. I'm telling you. I told you that Jesse Barr is the greatest, and now we proved it. But you see, Dutch Mantell made a couple of mistakes. First of all, his first mistake was getting in the ring with an ex-Olympian like Jesse Barr, but his second mistake was taking a hold of me. In desperation, trying to save that precious belt of his, Dutch Mantell reached over to the side of the ring, and he grabbed me, and he pulled me in the ring, and that's when I had to do something, Lance. I don't like to get physical. But I took my hand, and I slapped him up against the head one time, and I slapped him again, and then that's when Jesse took over, and Jesse Barr gave him the worst beating that he's ever had since he's been in professional wrestling. That's what happened to Dutch Mantell, and I wish you had been there to see it. I wish everybody could have been there.
I wish I'd have been there, too, Jimmy.
And that's why I am claiming the Mid-America Heavyweight Championship for Jesse Barr, because Dutch Mantell was such a coward, he grabbed that belt and ran, and we were standing there tall in the ring like the champions that we are, and he was running like the coward that he is. So I'm claiming the Mid-America title for Jesse Barr. And besides that, Jesse Barr has something that nobody else so far has gotten. The complete, the full financial backing of the Cornett Estate. I haven't had this much confidence in anybody else, but I've got it in Jesse Barr. Get a shot of this man. He's great. Come on. Get a shot of this man. He is the greatest athlete I've ever seen.
Well, Jimmy, that sounds like high confidence indeed when you talk about putting the entire Cornett Estate. I will reserve any comments about the Mantell Barr match. I was not
don't
there.
Don't reserve anything, Lance. Well, you missed it. You should have been there.
Yeah, okay.
But don't reserve anything. I just told you all about it.
We're going to have a chance to see Jesse in action today, and so why don't we do that? Let's
why
get to it.
That?
Jimmy Cornette.
In Chip Wrestling, the Sheepherders have come in rather strongly, to say the very least.
They have indeed. They had a rugged match with Gary Taylor and Jacques Rougeau.
By golly, I'll tell you one thing for a fact. They got a couple of guys that can go when they're in Taylor and Rougeau. Let's see if we can't take a look at some of the highlights of that particular match.
We are underway with Championship Wrestling. Hello, everybody. I'm Randy Hales. Dave Brown, our special guest at the Mid-South Coliseum in Memphis, Tennessee for Championship Wrestling. This opening match, the Sheepherders, Jonathan Boyd, Luke Williams against the T.O. Luke Williams with that stick from the flagpole, catches him with it just shortly after the bell has rung. Rougeau is caught, and Taylor too, and Luke Williams coming right out after him, runs him into the ring post. Jonathan Boyd pounding away at Terry Taylor, really working on him hard. Taylor didn't have a chance to start. He's busted open. Referee Paul Morton sending Rougeau back to the corner. Luke Williams and Jonathan Boyd double teaming. Taylor really caught bad, and here comes Jacques Rougeau in, but Jonathan Boyd double teaming from the Sheepherders. Taylor busted open very quickly during the match. The flagpole was used on Taylor. Taylor kicks, he's fighting back. But the Sheepherders really has Taylor in a bunch of bad shape, I'm telling you. Williams pounding away. He takes Taylor down to the canvas and drops across the big elbow. Picks him up by the hair. A tag on Jonathan Boyd. And Williams holds him, and here comes Jacques Rougeau in to help. But the referee's sending him out, and the Sheepherders, masters of double teaming, pounding away. Jonathan Boyd really working on Terry Taylor. Taylor in desperate need of a tag. Double teaming again. Here comes Rougeau. Rougeau catches Luke Williams, but Taylor still unable to get over and get a tag. Into the knee of Jonathan Boyd. A big right hand to the top of the eye of Taylor. Oh, man, I'm telling you. Caught him with a big elbow. Count of one, but Luke Williams, a mercenary, no doubt, refuses to allow the pin. Tag on Jonathan Boyd, and Boyd going to work on Taylor. Williams out, and Jonathan Boyd. A tremendous amount of punishment on Terry Taylor. Luke Williams in now, and he catches him, puts Terry Taylor down to the canvas. Has him up by the hair. The crowd getting behind Taylor. A knee to the midsection, and Taylor goes down. A knee to the top of the head by Luke Williams. Into the elbow of Jonathan Boyd. Taylor really busted open as the Sheepherders continue to apply punishment. Williams out on the turnbuckles, and he has that cane again, or the steel flagpole pounding at Terry Taylor as Jonathan Boyd continues the punishment on Terry Taylor. Taylor is about out of it. Boyd found it. Tag on Luke Williams. And Williams catches him with the right hand. Taylor trying to get over and get a tag with Jacques Rougeau. He might be able to do it. He's very close. But Luke Williams prevents the tag. Williams has Taylor. A reversal. Taylor gets him. Terry desperately needs to get over and get a tag, but Jonathan Boyd tagged in, and he prevents it from happening. Taylor came so very close. Terry put down to the canvas again. Jonathan Boyd fires him in, and this is his headbutt that we've seen him do. And Taylor absolutely out. A count of one, a two count, and he gets a count of three in 4 minutes, 35 seconds.
Now, when you look at the statistics on it, 4 minutes, 35 seconds, no doubt, a very impressive win for the team of the Sheepherders, Luke Williams and Jonathan Boyd, going against what has been a substantial team indeed of Taylor and Rougeau.
Substantial nothing. That is what's going to happen to every bloody Yank we get in with. Yeah, I'll tell you one thing. Billy Dundee said we'd like it here, and we're trying to figure out what he bloody meant. Now we know why Billy Dundee's been here for such a long time, because you stinking Southern Yanks couldn't wrestle your way out of a bloody paper bag. See this flag here?
This flag
is going to be flying over all the rings and all the arenas. The Sheepherd champions in 37 different countries are going to squat. There's going to be no ground given. We are going to demolish every team
in
it. And if you don't think we are going to do what we say, you watch what we do now.
We'll be sitting right here to watch it. As a matter of fact, it's Jonathan Boyd ringing the bell for Paper, who has had no respite from the action, and once again a two count. He breaks it at the two count.
Williams tags Boyd.
Bust a couple of boards over the head of Boyd and Williams. And,
Get him back out of here, man! Where are they? The pretty dude for that flagpole, aren't they? Where are they?
Obviously, they think this is so tough. They say New Zealand is so tough. Those guys come out here. We're not leaving till they come out here.
Get them out here. They want a street fight when we're ready. We got an equalizer. Let's go.
Come on. Anybody could hit somebody in the head, in the back of the head, and get a win like you did. But you face us face to face, and you'll see that Terry Taylor.
Come on, get him out.
I want him out.
Come on, get him out.
The Sheepherd is not coming out here.
Why not?
Because I said tonight, and you
why is that your face busted up, Eddie?
I came here for that man's not trying to take care of it. You didn't
Eddie,
have any business.
Eddie, busted me up,
come on,
man.
They like to jump out when they feel like it.
Let's go. Come on.
They like to jump out. Get them out of here for so long.
We'll take a break right now, and we'll be back with more wrestling action in a while.
Minute time limit match at a total weight of 442 pounds from parts unknown, the Masked Marauders, going against him at a total of 450 pounds from Montreal, Canada, Jacques Rougeau, and from Vero Beach, Florida, Terry Taylor. This match one fall, 15-minute time limit. Jerry Calhoun is the referee.
Woogie, going to try to get her down to just one man from each side in there. I would not want to be the Masked Marauders going against Rougeau and Taylor as hot as they are at this point about the sheepherders.
They are indeed a bit upset. Terry Taylor starting against the shorter of the Masked Marauders. Terry over to the corner, makes the tag on Jacques Rougeau. Terry fires him into the rope, sets him up. And Jacques Rougeau let him have it right in the midsection. Rougeau, the body slam on the Marauder. Over to the corner, the tag by Rougeau. Terry Taylor with the upper arm gets the Marauder off his feet. Terry got a twist on that arm. Put on the side of the head. Marauder able to get a foot over the bottom rope. That's going to mean a break. Marauder complaining to the referee. Not sure why. Maybe he thought he was a little slow about calling for the break on the rope there. Terry grabs the arm again. The Marauder swings by the corner, makes the tag on his partner. Picked him straight up in the air and dropped him off his feet down to the mat. Jacques Rougeau in after the tag. Rougeau, very agile wrestler. Out of Montreal, Canada. He's got some moves. Rougeau working on that left arm. The Marauder on the mat. Jacques had the arm up behind the bag and was just dropping down on it. Terry Taylor takes over where Rougeau left off with the arm. He's got it hammered up behind the back. Trying to look for his corner, find his partner over there, but he was a long way from the corner. Taylor and Rougeau make a tag again. Rougeau, that double knee lift as he just leaps off the mat, brings the knees up under the chin of his opponent. Taylor with the drop kick as Rougeau had fired the Marauder into the rope. Taylor was right there. Terry Taylor has got the cover. Whoops. Okay, I think the Marauder's foot was briefly over the bottom rope. Referee called a break. Taylor slams him down. Rougeau had made the tag. He drops down. Marauder tried to roll out of the way, but Rougeau still able to plant a foot on him. Backbreaker by Rougeau. Tag on Terry Taylor. 3.5 minute mark coming up in this match. It's been all Rougeau and Taylor. Backflip off the rope. Taylor tags Rougeau. Backs the Marauder to the rope. Fires him across the way. Rougeau off the middle rope with a flying drop kick. Down to one, two, and three. Taylor and Rougeau exhibiting some of the fine teamwork that we have seen in the past from this team. Boy, they set the Marauder up, and Jacques Rougeau up on the middle rope. He had to regain his balance as the Marauder was stumbling around, but he found the range with that drop kick standing off the rope. 3:52 and the win for Terry Taylor, Jacques Rougeau.
Boy, he'll wind your clock with that drop kick, won't he, when he comes
up? He kicked him 3/4 of the way across the ring when he made contact with him.
Man, oh, man. Well, you know, as we said before the bout got underway, Rougeau and Taylor are tough anytime. Fine couple of young wrestlers, but, man, they're hot today about the sheep.